In 1943, 14,000 kilometres northeast from Perth, in the Pilbara region of Western Australia, once had a town called Wittenoom. Now, it doesn't exist. It's had over 20,000 residents, and it's killed thousands. It still continues to cause pain and death to many who lived or even visited this town. But why? Why has a town that once had hundreds of residents now become one of the most dangerous places on earth? This is a story about a town. It's also a story about how something we once thought was completely safe to becoming one of the most dangerous things on this planet, asbestos.
Larson's quality asbestos is a modern marvel. This stuff can do just about everything. And the best part about it is, it's perfectly safe.
Asbestos is a great vitamin. Just open up the package, pour some on your plate, and then enjoy.
Make sure to go down to your local store and buy some today.
Larson's Asbestos is the bestos.
The areas around Wittenoom are surrounded with gorges. A gorge is a narrow valley between hills or mountains, and they usually have water running through the middle. There is a gorge called Yemhaya Gorge. This is where blue asbestos started to be mined in the late 1930s. In early 1940s, blue asbestos was found in Wittenoom Gorge, 23 kilometres from Yemhaya Gorge. So mining in Yemhaya stopped and moved to Wittenoom. A mining company was founded by Lang Hancock. It was called Australian Blue Asbestos, which operated mines at Wittenoom Gorge. Just a couple of years later, CSR, the company you've probably bought sugar from, bought the mines in Wittenoom. Then, the birth of Wittenoom began. At the beginning, Wittenoom was used to house the miners and their families, but it eventually grew into a bustling town with hundreds of residents.
In 1948, in the shadow of the Hammersley Range, a town was born. A town which in 4 years has grown to be the largest inland town in the north of Western Australia, Wittenoom.
Wittenoom was a very unique town, just like any other in the middle of the outback. It was isolated, it had nothing nearby. They had an airport, and most transport to and from Wittenoom was done by air. They had a cinema which back then was called Picture Gardens, and then next to that was a cafe called Geo's Joint. They played sports, they even had a racetrack where they had race horses, which was $10 for a day pass, which to me seems very expensive for the time. They had a school, a police station, eventually a hospital was built, which before that they used the Royal Flying Doctor. The Royal Flying Doctor is a non-profit doctor service that flies out to towns in the outback. They had asbestos shoveling competitions. Leave a comment if you're interested in joining my asbestos shoveling competition. What most of the residents didn't know was something was killing them. There has been thousands of deaths from Wittenoom because of asbestos. The mining for blue asbestos at Wittenoom stopped in 1966, but it wasn't for the reason you'd think, safety, but because of profit. The town still continued to, well, be a town just without the mines after the shutdown in 1966. But it was over 10 years when the mines stopped that the government told the residents, look, it's unsafe and you need to leave. Most did, but some stayed till the very last day. They refused to leave Wittenoom because it was their home, their life. This was their childhood memories. Asbestos is natural and comes from the earth. It can be found above ground or below ground.
The drive section is 8 feet by 7 feet, the top 2 feet containing seams of blue asbestos from 1/10 of an inch to 2 inches. After boring, 2 firings are made. The first to remove the mullock, the second to obtain the upper 2 feet of valuable asbestos fibre.
This is in Wittenoom Gorge, and you can see the blue asbestos still in its natural state. Asbestos comes in 6 types, but they are all carcinogens, which, in other words, they all cause cancer to your body. Blue asbestos is by far the most deadly form of asbestos due to the length of its filaments that can pierce lung tissue and can't be contained by the body's natural defenses. When you inhale or ingest these fibers, your body just cannot break them down because they are so powerful.
Scarring of lung tissue due to asbestos deposition in the lung. It's a progressive disease, results in more and more scarring with the passage of time, and as the scarring increases, lung function diminishes and people become progressively more short of breath. This can go on to an end-stage condition where people with asbestosis are unable to engage in any sort of physical activity.
If you want an idea of what mesothelioma does to you, take a look at this. That is a normal lung. It's about the size and shape that a lung should be. And that is the lung of someone who's died from mesothelioma. All this white stuff around it is the tumour. And you can see how it's grown right around the lung and crushed it to about a quarter of its normal size. Now what has happened is that the victim has essentially been suffocated to death.
Blue asbestos fibres, they're 2.5 to 10 micrometres. So if you grab your tape measure and you measure 1 mil on the tape, that's 1,000 micrometres. So try to picture that looking at a fibre that's 10 micrometres. So when you look at 1 mil, that's 1,000 micrometres. Now picture yourself looking at 10 micrometres. Wittenoom Gorge had mines and mills set up to mine and process the asbestos, which was in the Wittenoom Gorge, 10 kilometres from the town. You can see asbestos smoke coming out of the mills, which I'm sure this would have travelled to the town. This photo shows three guys loading the processed asbestos in bags wearing a mask, but not everyone wore one. And you can notice the company name on the bags, Australian Blue Asbestos. They loaded the bags of asbestos on open trucks, which you can see here, and then drove to Point Sampson Dock, which was about 300 kilometres away, to be stored in sheds. The blue piles you see around Wittenoom are asbestos tailings, and from my understanding, these are the leftovers after the workers at the mills have separated the asbestos from the ore. It's mixed with other stuff, so it's not pure asbestos, and they couldn't make a profit from this. So they use trucks to dump this stuff all around town. There's mountains of this stuff reaching up to 40 meters high. They used asbestos tailings for everything, and I'm not kidding you. They used it for the roads. The cricket grounds were made of this stuff to make the ground softer. When you drove on the roads, it would send the asbestos dust flying everywhere. This stuff was like playing with sand at the beach. This photo are two boys and they're playing in this stuff. I mean, man, this hurts my heart. The one on the left is Philip Noble, and the one on the right is Ross Munro. Both died in their 30s from cancer related to asbestos.
It has played a tremendously important role in the improvement of our standard of living. As you might expect, the Greeks had a name for it. They called it the unquenchable, indestructible stone. They called it asbestos.
I find it so fascinating to think that asbestos is banned in over 50 countries because of the dangers that it causes, yet we used asbestos for so many things. Like when a tobacco company called Lorillard Tobacco sold different brands of cigarettes. One of those brands that they sold were Kent, and Kent came out with a new type of cigarette, Kent Micronite, and it had compressed blue asbestos in the filter. Yay, what a time to be alive.
Change to Kent, change to Kent, change to Kent with the Micronite filter.
I suggest that you take the Kent carton test and just see for yourself what a difference Kent's can make. You'll find that Kent's Micronite filter gives you high filtration to help you keep your smoking moderate.
I smoke Kent cigarettes. Why don't you get yourself a carton and try them? Why don't you get yourself a carton and try them? Why don't you get yourself a carton and try them? Why don't you get yourself a carton and try them?
There's a scene in The Wizard of Oz where they're in a poppy field. The lady with all the powers, she changes the weather and she makes it snow in the poppy fields.
It is! Oh, maybe that'll help! Oh, but couldn't help.
Does help. Dorothy, you're waking up! Unusual weather we're having, ain't it?
This isn't obviously real snow. It's asbestos. Pure asbestos. So what's happened to Wittenoom now? Well, here's the timeline of Wittenoom leading up to this very day. In 1943, Wittenoom was built to house the workers who worked at the mines and the mills. Just a few years later, it became a town that was bustling with life. Mining in Wittenoom stopped in 1966, over 20 years since the mining began there. In 1978, the Western Australian government began phasing down the town, which means limiting the services to the town. They encouraged the residents to relocate because of concerns over health risks. Health risks from the airborne asbestos fibres, and remember, that's over 10 years since the mining stopped that the government came out and said Wittenoom is unsafe. Between 1986 and 1992, the school, nursing post and police station were permanently closed. Alternative services were provided mostly from Tom Price, which is a mining town over 100 kilometres away from Wittenoom. In 1993, the airport was officially closed. In 2006, the government shut off the power, leaving people to buy their own generators. In June 2007, the town ceased to exist. It was removed from the maps. The signs that once showed the directions to Wittenoom were gone. In 2008, it was declared a contaminated site under the Contaminated Sites Act 2003. Then, the government started to demolish the buildings one by one and put warning signs all around Wittenoom to warn people that their life could be cut short if they visit. All these signs didn't stop people from coming though. Like, check this lady out who decided to cook some marshmallows at Wittenoom. And these girls who posed right next to the asbestos tailings, like look at it, it's literally right there next to him. And this man, have a look, he's holding the asbestos up in the air like it's some kind of trophy. Good on ya, mate. This man though, he really deserves a trophy, this one. A durry and a beer. Talk about living life on the edge. There's a band called Midnight Oil, and they made a song called Blue Sky Mine. It's about Wittenoom and the mining that was done there and the deaths from the asbestos. There's a part of the song that sticks into my head a lot, and it's when they sing, "If the sugar refining company won't save me, who's gonna save me?" As you're watching this video, the government's demolished every single building that's left. There's nothing left at all but land. The mines, the mills, all of it, it's all gone. Their plan is to put the tailings in a hole like this one and seal it up for good. Kinda like what they did at Chernobyl when they put that dome over the most toxic part of the city. Everything else, like the cars, the machines from the mines, the stuff from the buildings, it's all gonna be buried under the ground and sealed. The land that once had a town is now fenced up, so even driving along those roads that made Wittenoom, Wittenoom is a no-go. The entrances to the mines are sealed off with, which looks like concrete. A lot of the residents that left Wittenoom left a lot of their stuff behind, like cars, buses, camper vans, and kitchen stuff. There's a photo that comes to my mind a lot when making this video. It's a photo of a gem shop sign. The lady who worked and owned it was Lorraine Thomas. She lived in Wittenoom for 40 years and she was the very last person to leave Wittenoom.